But you know, there's no stopping this rider. This is Claudio Chiappucci. He's determined to attack, he says, all the way to the finish of this Tour de France in Paris, and he's pushing the pace again on the climb of the L'Ecru. There's no real big climbs on this race. They're all fourth and third categories today, and six of them coming. But they're short and they're sharp, because over the back end of the course, the riders are facing up to the Tour of Flanders race route before they break off and head into Brussels. And this is the group at the back here, Thierry Marie of France. And number 21 is Claudio Chiappucci. 92 is Johan Cacchio, former champion of Belgium and classic winner. And 51 is Greg LeMond. Well, this is a strange alliance. They've gone clear at about 22 kilometres today on the climb of the L'Ecru. And they're facing up 140 kilometres in the lead if they stay away to the end. The time check coming up there for Greg LeMond. And the alliance of the two, the American and the Italian, well, that's a turnabout, because in the 1990 Tour de France, it was the great battle, and LeMond had to chase Chiappucci down the Tourmalet to take back the leader's yellow jersey and go on to win that Tour de France. But it's the Gatorade team of Gianni Bugno and Laurent Fignon who are mustering up the chase. Benestos are helping out a little bit. There's Thierry Marie, three times winner of the prologue. Remember that great breakaway a year ago, over 240 kilometres in the lead before he won the stage, which gave him back very briefly the leader's yellow jersey, and now he's in the move again. It's good to see the stars on the attack though, because the weather conditions are bad, that there is a chance of a good time gain here. They're sprinting out the small time bonuses. And Claudio Chiappucci takes the 6 seconds ahead of Laurent Jalabert. There's a little surprise. Chiappucci really can turn out the sprints when he wants to, and he's going to keep it going. Jalabert has sat up, but he's going to have to take him on and catch him up here, because the conditions now are atrocious, and there's cobblestones on today's route too as we approach.
There, the man who started it all is Claudio Chiappucci. He had the audacity to nip off from the main pack just after that 15-man group was caught, and so he's the one really who's stirred this little lot up, and all due success to him. So the other rider in there, Brian Holm at the back, riding for the Tulip team, is the one who makes up that foursome, and they've got quite a useful gap at the moment. In fact, he's getting more towards half a minute here, according to my timekeeper and note-taker, Mr. Brian Montgomery, who has got the watch on this little lot. So we had one 16-second check. Now we're getting it up to towards half a minute, and that is vital. We're just some 20 kilometres towards the finish, at about 12 miles as such. And there we are, the big group going underneath it, in towards this finish in Brussels, where we're going to finish past the Automium, the great big aluminium multi-ball device up in the sky. It's got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 of these great big roundels connected by tubes up which the public travel by virtue of escalators and so on. And it was built in 1958 when they had the great big world show there. In fact, I remember going there myself, and I discovered in talking to my colleague here who's doing the commentary for our Dutch viewers that in fact he wasn't born then. It made me feel a bit old, I can tell you. Anyway, that's the sight that they will see as they're going in towards the finish. This great exhibition area, they're going to come up the straight finishing line and finish almost just outside the great big halls where they have the Dutch Motor Show and many other shows as well. That's up the Boulevard de Santander. A spot in Brussels, just a bit of cobbles to bounce across, and of course these are the most diabolical conditions if you're turning into another side road. This is where you bounce around. These aren't too bad compared with the Paris-Roubaix cobbles, but certainly after you've been in the saddle now, as these riders have been in the saddle for something like 158 or 159 kilometres in the saddle, then certainly the bouncing, the buffeting, the bumping is one of the last things you want. So what you do, you just see your hands here, you have to relax a little bit, just get your elbows bent and let the handlebars just bounce up and down, but still hold control of them. And meantime, your bum has to go up and down on that saddle. There's nothing much you can do about that. If you try and lift your bum up and get your hands on the handlebars, then you get a buffeting up to the palms of your hands, and that causes vibration down your body. So it's better to sit back a bit. And whoops, I told you about the corners, being very careful. Now, this is going to play right into the hands of these four riders, because the big bunch, when they hit that one, will find it very difficult. They'll have to go around a lot slower. The riders from the... Oh, Yates has now moved up behind the jersey of Bugno. Bugno here and Yates. Yates taking the outside line behind Bugno. So there, the British jersey, the national championship jersey, I keep mentioning, so sorry for boring you, but it's the first time we've seen it in the Tour de France. Yates, who at Basquiat a few years ago set up the fastest time trial in the Tour de France, riding for Motorola at the moment, And there we are, they're getting onto the cobbles. Yates has decided to put his hands onto the top of the bars, again for this bouncing and buffeting that you get. Just the way, look, and the same thing for Emote. And that's exactly what I thought would happen. We're going to get some awful crashes under these conditions because, there's a whole load of riders come down. They're grabbing the against the fence. The bikes are all over the place. This is the trouble with these sort of conditions, and you can see why today they do wear the crash hats. Nobody questions that at all in Brussels, in Belgium, because you have to wear your crash hat under conditions like that, and you can see why as mayhem sets place now. And the pecking order now goes on. They try and find the Butler rider just come down with a bang, 133, picking himself up again. That's Gerrit de Vries. There, Aidan Tan is in trouble as well. So he's down, and we've got one or two riders who are really, really hurt in this one. One of Aidan Tan's teammates there, Henk Jalta, has gone down with a bang. So this is real mayhem as far as these riders are concerned. All the cars have been pulled behind. So these riders now, that's Dan Bakker from PDM. They'll all get themselves together, this group of riders, I should think, and start to come in as De Vries, I think that is down on the floor as well. This has been a real nasty bang as far as they're concerned. And yes, Gerrit de Vries, who was leading all the way into Bordeaux, is now well and truly hammered onto the ground. This has been a really nasty crash, but many of the riders, they don't seem to me to have actually broken anything, but I'm no doctor at this distance, but they slide mainly, and then once you get over the shock of it all, you've got to get back on your bike. That little regroup, the mechanics will be there. What often happens now in those circumstances, they take a quick look through, and except for Aidan Tan, who's the number one rider from the Alios Tir team, the mechanics will look after the rider. But what often happens in those conditions, if their lower place riders have been fetched down, the number one team car keeps on going behind the main pack, and it's the number two team car that pulls in and starts to service them and help them, because they're going to lose so much time, they don't want the number one car to be out of touch with the rest of the race. So that's the tactics as Kier Putti winding it up with Le Mans, and they begin to get a little bit of a breakaway going here, just edging it through. And Leger talking back to Le Monde, giving him some information about the time gap they have got. And we've lost touch of the times now, because with the 5 kilometre to go, another chance to do a time check on that disrupted bunch. You saw Bugno getting towards the front. If all the top riders recognise under these conditions, they've got to get near the front to try and stay out of trouble. And these four have done an absolutely marvellous thing. All credit to Le Mans, all credit to Kip Pucci, marked well by Jalabert and by Brian Holm. These four riders then are going to give everybody something to talk about. This tour has been one of the greatest talking points I've been on for many years. It keeps changing all the time. The tactics are changing. And whilst they sort of had that confident air about them, the top riders, that they'll sort it all out in the Alps, and they may well do so yet. It's attacks like this, it's attacks like we've seen going so far, that have caused one or two riders to shock a few of the top men and make it very hard indeed. It hasn't been one of those races when you can just amble along at a steady speed and not go and get some of your strength zapped out by the conditions. Their average yesterday, 47 kilometres per hour, just some 27 and a half miles an hour. The average yesterday, into a slight drifting headwind, that takes strength out of your legs. So here they are then, showing the world what it's all about. Greg LeMond has come back with a bang, and Kier Pucci in there, always gutsy, always prepared to have a go. He'd been battling it out all day today, Kier Pucci. He went with an early break, he's recovered, he got caught, he went away again. Brian Holm moving on the left hand side, Jalabert on the right, LeMond and Kier Pucci, remember the 20 seconds bonus, then 12, then 8, on this slight uphill bit here. Brian Holm, who's not done any work so far in this four-man group, he's gone away just off the front as our helicopter nearly ran into the Automum. We've got the camera down low and the big screen up there for the people to see this one. Are they going to see Le Mans? Are they going to see Kip Pucci? Who's going to take this one? Holm has wound his way to the front at long last. We've not seen much of him. Kip Pucci stuck behind. In fact, no, it's Jalabert on the front. Jalabert has certainly got the best sprint of this lot, but I think Kip Pucci and Le Mans will be happy with the time they've gained. Edrich Jalabert winds his way up. He's going to get this stage. Jalabert gets it then. So Jalabert takes first place there. Kip Pucci was second. Le Mans was fourth. Brian Holm in between them. So Kip Pucci has now got 12 seconds, so whatever happens now, he's leapt over Gianni Bugno. Kier Pucci could move up into fourth place. Doing the sums here, he was in fact 2 minutes down on Bauer. Bauer's at 3:11, so he's got 2:10 down there. If he goes as far as that 2:10, then undoubtedly Kier Pucci could well move up into third spot. So we've juggled all the positions yet again. And here they go. Now, it won't be 2 minutes, I don't think, from here. So they look like they're going to move up a bit behind Heppner and Kipucci, and Le Mans could find themselves in fifth and sixth place, Kipucci being the best at lot. The sprint coming up then on the line. And so it was Jan Muzio for the Lotto team taking the bunch sprint. That'll keep him in the green jersey of the points. 121 the gap then that was between them and the yellow jersey and most of the adversaries, whilst Jan Muzio, who stealthily got that green jersey, he's been creeping up all the time, just getting the bunch sprint day after day.
Greg Le Mans is climbing up to fifth overall now, and the press annoying him at the finish. Property in world cycling, even if he didn't win the Tour de France last year. And the only way of escape is over the barriers and into the safety of underneath this truck. He's asking for a little bit of time to get changed.
I want to change. Sorry, please.
Greg, you started this Tour de France off in a very tired state, but you seem to be getting better as the days go by.
Yeah, I feel better. I felt better since the Teton trial. So
these stages seem very open, and the teams like Banesto and Gatorade don't seem to be able to control the racing.
Well, when I knew it was the opportune time to go, because the break before with Hampson, Rooks and all that, everybody chased hard, and I knew everybody was tired, and it started raining, and Kiyopuchi went for the hill cream. I just followed, and I knew that was going to be a decisive moment. Everybody was very tired.
You must be feeling a lot more confident than you were a few days ago when I spoke to you in San Sebastian.
Well, it's not the mountains. You wait and see how I film the time trial. Today is just an opportunity time, and I knew in one of these days I could do that. That's what I was hoping for, was a day like today, so.
Every opportunity is a good one, though, in the Tour de France.
Especially when you start bad.
By the way, it must have been a great morale booster there for Greg. The overall lead, Pascal Lino, still leading this race. Steve Bauer profited on the day too, and he climbed up into second place. This was the stage result. Jalabert beating Kiyopuchi, Home and Le Mans. Overall, though, 3 minutes 11 seconds, the gap back to Bauer and Kiyopuchi.
There were the lovely sight of this ground. In those grounds in 1958, there were loads and loads of special displays set up. People built enormous pavilion. Among the British Pavilion, actually, there were some trees, and we weren't allowed to cut the trees down. The British Pavilion actually had the trees growing through the pavilion. So that was what they had to do when they built that the exhibition. And after the exhibition was over, everybody was supposed to take down all their stands and take them away, and everybody had their own national exhibition built in a national style. But one or two of the countries suddenly realized they might as well give it to the Belgian nation, which is cheaper than knocking it down. The trouble was, half the people all wanted to give their stands to the Belgian nation, and they couldn't allow that. They're up, so Jalabert winner of the stage. So Pascal Lino in the bunch, we understand, still in yellow, as we would have thought, but Jalabert, happy man then to add that to his many, many successes, and some compensation again to Onsafe, having lost that yellow jersey when Zilla took it on the stage into San Sebastian. And now the team from Onsafe have a success today, with Jalabert winding up that sprint. And at the back behind him, Kiyopuchi and Le Mans, a bit disappointed, but a great sprinter like that, there's no way they could. Formation of that group, yes, but Mazzeo at 1 minute 22 seconds leading in the main peloton, such as it was. I mean, they upended themselves on the way in. Well, up in Belgium now, no problems with the barrage as such. The Tour so far has got through without major incidents. Once, of course, we had the problems with the seven cars being set on fire down in Spain. And after that, now we've seen it having a good run through and skirting the edge of northern side of France. It should be okay to miss the barrage.
About the rides at the top?
Well, there's been a lot of action happening in the bunch anyway. The last few days have been just incredible pace. 46 and a half yesterday average in the rain, and 48 the day before. I've never ridden so hard in my whole life. You've got Kiyopuchi and Le Mans, they just seem to be driving. I think Greg's trying to get some time before the mountains. And yesterday, Indurain had me a little bit worried. He's my favourite. I want that man to win, you know. But I get the feeling he's a bit nervous. And I think it's because of Bugno. Bugno's like, he's the cool, calm and collected man at the moment. I just sense that Indurain's not quite as cool as he used to be, or he was in the Giro, you know. There's more competition. Kiyopuchi and Greg.